Harper Teen and Harper Audio present The New David Espinoza by Fred Aceves. Performed by Christian Barillas. For all of you struggling with a silent hurt, you matter. You are not alone. You are loved. I see you. Prologue. It sucks being the skinniest guy at Color High. If kids rag on me when I'm fully clothed, just imagine their joy when I whip my shirt off, exposing my stickman physique. That's why I rush to PE and change before anybody shows up. It's why I volunteer to be ball boy every semester. After Coach Carlson's final whistle sends everybody else running to the locker room, I take my time herding the soccer balls in the Florida heat. Today, the last day of my junior year, it's no different. By the time I'm carrying a net bag of soccer balls through the doorway, the locker room is mostly abandoned. The last of the boys are turning in their uniforms and padlocks to coach. I swing the bag off my shoulder and drop it into the large metal basket. Then I walk deep back into the last row of lockers. Nobody's around. Lucky me. I spin the combination into the lock and open the metal door for the last time this year. I grab the bottom of my sweaty Color High Cougars t-shirt and start peeling it off. The moment it's almost over my head, pain explodes inside the left side of my face. Someone punched me. What the hell? The vented blue doors around me go blurry, and the t-shirt falls to the floor. I tip sideways, then back, then forward, my legs trying to find balance. Next thing I know, I'm on the floor, my stomach, chest, and half my face cold. The stench of teenage sweat and feet is way stronger down here. There's a high-pitched cackle. Ricky's trademark laugh. I could pick him out from about a million idiots, just from that sound. I strain to lift my head and catch a glimpse of Ricky's grin through my blurry vision before he turns to leave. Though Ricky might lift weights, he's not what you'd consider muscular at a wiry 5'8". He's not even the in-your-face bully who puts hands on you, from what I've seen. He just makes fun of people. Like when he cracks on Ricardo's fat rolls when we change. He nicknamed me Fuckstick that one time he saw my bony torso, which got others in PE using that nickname. But from that to punching me? I mean, sometimes I get shoved against lockers and kicked and punched in the arm real hard, but never by Ricky. And never in the face. As the bell announces the official end of school this year, I check for blood. Nothing on my fingers. I push myself up off the floor and stand, still dazed and super confused. A real guy would shake it off and go after Ricky, beat his ass good. What can I do, though? Not a damn thing. I'm not saying that to seem less like a wimp or anything. It's just that at my size, all I can do is shake it off, forget the whole thing and try to move on with my life. I remember what my mom used to say whenever we had a bad turn of luck. Things could always be worse. So even though my head is wobbly, my cheek stings, and my shoulder somehow aches, I can find the silver lining. At least it was only one punch. At least there's no blood. At least I don't gotta deal with more bullying for 3 months. At least nobody saw it happen. 1. Hours later, in the safety of home, I still haven't shoved the whole Ricky incident out of my head. Enough worrying about it, I tell myself. Technically, Ricky punched me last school year. Now it's officially summer. 3 worry-free months ahead of me. I get amped about that, about tonight especially, the fun that begins just as soon as I change into formal clothes. I put on my black slacks and take in the bare torso in the mirror. A recent 4-inch growth spurt has put me at 6 feet. Tall is good, but that upward stretch has enhanced my skinniness like when you pull apart taffy. Why couldn't I have grown the other way, too? I slip my arms through the sleeves of my white dress shirt, covering up my knobby shoulders. I button it from the top, hiding my bird chest and pokey ribs. My twig arms are also hidden. I love that about long sleeves. I consider my reflection. My girlfriend, Karina, often wears black because she says it has a slimming effect. So I figured this shirt, the opposite color, would help me out some by giving me the illusion of bulk. Nope. That's right. I, David Espinoza, have a girlfriend. Me, the guy who, as of today, has experienced every known form of bullying known to man. We've been going out for 4 months now. The other miracle of this year is that I'm going to my first real party. You know, the high school kind, with alcohol and fun, not cake and parents. It's a big deal. The end of the year party the whole school has been talking about. Actually, it's Karina who got invited, by her friend Emily in drama club, and I'm tagging along with Karina. Just like my best friend Miguel is tagging along with Karina's best friend. But still, if only I can figure out how to knot this tie so it's the right length. Come on, I tell myself. The third time's a charm. Nope. Too short. I give it a fourth, more careful try. Really take my time. The damn thing droops 2 inches past my belt. I take a deep breath to keep my anger at bay. Most of the time I catch it before it grabs hold of me. Fifth try. Here we go. I grit my teeth as I tighten the knot and slide it up to the collar. About 3 inches too short again. I could sell used cars like this, but it's not okay for a party. Stupid fucking tie, I say under my breath. I pull it over my head and fling it across the room. It twists in the air and lands on my small bed. What a stupid invention. A bit of fancy fabric to dangle around your neck, serving no purpose. And why have a dress code for a house party? I mean, who does that? We're not actors going to the Oscars. And why am I even going? If I get harassed at school when adults are nearby, supposedly watching out, what might happen when it's only kids around? Right away, Ricky pops into my head again. My blood simmers and I start pacing. Ellis comes to mind, this brace-faced guy who flipped my food tray over last week. The ketchup on my face and shirt entertained the hell out of everybody who saw it, the laughter loud enough to draw the attention of half the lunchroom. When Mr. Trevors walked over to ask what happened, I told him I tripped. I remember last month in history before the teacher showed up, when Julian hit me in the head with a marker from across the room. Bring it back to me or I'll beat the shit out of you. I did, walking all those steps while every eyeball in the room followed me. This is how it happens. A horrible thought or memory drifts into my head. Another attaches to it, pulling another one behind, and so on, until I'm clenching my teeth and fists, pacing and wanting to kick some serious ass. That's where my thoughts end up every time. I come to a stop and find myself facing the Night Chaser movie poster hanging on my door. Van Nelson, the star of the movie, has a fierce scowl on his face, plus muscles to back it up. He uses them in the best fight scene of all time, at the end of the movie when he gets revenge on those guys who tried to frame him. So when my thoughts land on Ricky again, the sucker-punching bully materializes right here in my room. He's standing above me, cackling like the idiot he is. You messed with the wrong guy, Ricky. I throw 2 left jabs to his face, followed by a hard right hook. A strong kick to the chest splats him against the wall. When he wobbles toward me, I finish him with a roundhouse that knocks him out cold.
What you doing?
The question makes me jump, puts an end to my triumph. Once again, I'm in my bedroom, alone. Okay, not alone. My little sister, Gabby, is in the doorway. I turn. Confusion is bunching up her face, making her round cheeks even plumper. Well, this is awkward. You don't want your 8-year-old sister thinking you're some weirdo. I need to remember to shut my tricky door hard enough. Yet again, it has clicked away and swung open. So it's my bad. Gabby actually respects my knocking rule. I finally got Dad to start knocking too, which wasn't easy. He's a small-town Mexican who struggles to understand the concept of privacy the way the rest of us struggle with physics. Me? I ask Gabby. I was dancing.
For real?
Gabby's eyes go wide.
What kind of crazy dancing was that?
I snatch up the tie in case she wants to jump on my bed. I was trying some moves for the party. She takes a seat on my desk chair instead and swivels, considering what I said. With Gabby around, the anger has drained from me. I'm back to being chill, ready to give this tie another attempt.
I've never been to a night party, Gabby says. But you should probably not dance like you were dancing.
That makes me smile. How do you suggest I dance? She stops swiveling to think this through, hands clasped to the sides of the chair. She says,
you should look at how Karina and others are dancing and dance that way.
I stop messing with my tie to look at her. Good advice, I say, putting out my fist. Her 4 small knuckles press against mine. Hanging out with Gabby is the best. Over the years, little by little, she's turned into a real person. Gone from clueless and whiny to smart and fun. We cook together and play games and watch enough animal documentaries and Pixar movies to qualify as buddies. Sometimes I wonder if she isn't my actual best friend. If not, she's a close second to Miguel. Dad calls me a good brother for how tight we are, but the truth is I need her as much as she needs me. More than ever since Mom died 15 months ago. Cancer. A thought I push out of my head right now. Tonight, I'm all about positive thoughts. I slide the tie knot up again, feeling good about it. Yes. The bottom points to the top of my belt, as Dad says it should. I turn to face Gabby and punch my fists high in the air, like I won a marathon or something.
You look fancy,
she says. I am fancy, I tell her. Dad's the one who fired the butler, sold the mansion, and moved us to this part of town. Gabby smiles and says,
at least we still have the yacht.
I laugh, but Gabby cracks up for a good 10 seconds, slapping her knee and everything. She's the only person I know who laughs hardest at her own jokes. As she takes a slow spin in the chair, her single thick rope of black hair trails behind her. Despite a few loose strands, the French braid I did for her this morning is holding up. What can I say? My braiding game is tight. Gabby stops. She hops down from the chair, croaks, ribbit, and hops onto the bed, landing on all fours. Frogs are her thing, learning about them and sometimes, when she's in a goofy mood, hopping like them. After a hard rain, I sometimes take her to Collins Park to look for some. Her favorite shirt is one with this cartoon frog face on it. Her second favorite is a solid green t-shirt, which she calls frog-colored. I don't know why, but silly stuff like that coming from her weird brain makes me love her even more. I sit on the chair to put on my shoes. Dad walks in, sees me, and asks in Spanish,
has anybody seen my son, David?
Pronounces it David. Though his English is near perfect, it's always Spanish with him. Gabby and I switch when he's around. Gabby points to me.
I think that's him dressed up all fancy.
Dad and I are now the same height, and we both have short, barely combable hair. That's where the similarities between us end. I have brown hair instead of black, lighter skin like my mom had, and the skinniness that runs deep on that side of the family. He's brought me his suit jacket, which is my last hope to appear bigger, but the shoulder pads curve down the sides all clownish. I'm way too skinny, I say, handing it back.
Skinny or fat doesn't matter,
Dad says, setting a hand on my shoulder.
Being a man has nothing to do with how you look.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.